Hi everyone, and welcome to Module 3, and welcome to what is quite a hot August cycle tour day here in Cape Town. So, I just thought I would address one of the issues that came up in the small group forums that was raised by Shakira. Thank you very much for raising it. I hope I got your name right. And that is around how do we rank stakeholder objectives, and there were a couple of interesting ideas that became an issue. The first is around whether or not the reason for the slow growth of the application is the usability. So Shakira basically asserts that the issue for the slow growth is UX. However, if we listen to the stakeholders, they would say that the issue for slow product uptake is because of security, and that's an issue that's been raised more often. And so one of the questions that came up in the small group discussion was, how should we weight those up? Now, there are a couple of items there that I think are important for discussion. The first is recognizing that we as the UX practitioners are ourselves stakeholders, and that we ourselves are only one participant in the discussion. It's certainly not something which we can assert and say that we know better than everyone else. In fact, the entire reason why we should engage with the stakeholders is because we can't, from a position in isolation, come to a clear conclusion as to what it is that we want to ultimately build. And we need to also differentiate between what is a usability issue and what is an aesthetic issue. Before we delve into that in terms of like how we want to solve that problem, I think a critical thing that we want to that we should be concerning ourselves with is this matter of product success. Sometimes, and indeed this is a continual challenge that you're likely to have in your career, and that is that sometimes a product is not going to resonate no matter how usable it is, no matter how well planned it is, no matter how well designed it is, no matter how useful it in fact might be. Because they're a combination of factors that are exterior to the product itself that result in the success. You know, an example of that would be if you look at something like Friendster. You might say, well, what is Friendster? Well, Friendster actually predated Facebook by several years, predated MySpace, or was raised around about the same time, and yet it was ultimately defeated by Facebook. Many, many of the features that today we find in a product like Facebook were present already in Friendster. And in fact, ideas like the feed, the ideas of follows versus likes, and now just some of the recent additions to Facebook where there are things in addition to likes, such as, you know, hate, smile, share, those were things that were already present inside Friendster. Arguably, the UX team at Friendster might have said, well, we actually had a far better product, but it didn't resonate with users because users weren't ready for that. In fact, the simplicity and the stripped awayness of Facebook and the fact that it rolled out progressively across college campuses ensured that there was a slow groundswell of people who actually used the product. In the case of the chainmail product, which we're looking at now, I think we face the same challenge here, where security is the prime directive of the product. So if we were taking a Jobsian approach to it and kind of saying, let's say, totally focus on what the stakeholders are highlighting there, then by all means, we should be focusing on that. And I want to encourage you all in the remaining modules of the course to not lose sight of security, particularly when we get into issues like hypotheses, when we get into the actual wireframing and prototyping of the application. We're not looking to try and simply recreate an email web client. We're trying to look at something that directly addresses the needs of the stakeholders. Coming back now to Shakira's other point around us as stakeholders and us as people who should our objectives, as she puts in the forum, trump those of the other stakeholders. My advice on that to user group would be to say no. There are a couple of reasons for this. The first reason is that we ourselves will always have a selection bias, often that is going to be encouraged by our past experience. So for myself, my background as a software architect, I might end up with a solution that is perhaps beautifully architected, but that might de-emphasize some of the aesthetic. Similarly, a designer might take something that is overly, or not overly necessarily, but it is beautifully designed, but is not necessarily fundamentally functional. A business stakeholder might overburden the product with a need for revenue, you know, slap lots of ads everywhere to try and make the platform profitable. So really what we're looking to try and do is we're trying to find a balance between each of those stakeholder needs. Our role as the UX practitioner is to facilitate that discussion, is to facilitate that balance, to recognize our own prejudices, our own presuppositions, our own desires. Articulate those, share those with the group by all means, but compartmentalize between our goals as a stakeholder and then our role as a facilitator and a conciliator of each of these different requirements in the project. Stakeholders are going to have contradictory objectives. We as stakeholders will also have contradictory objectives. If we see ourselves as able to trump the objectives of others inside the group, of other stakeholders, then that means that the things that they're valuing are being discounted, which means we're going to end up with a product that is incorrectly balanced. It means that for the long-term facilitation of the project, it's going to be extremely hostile, because early on we're effectively saying that we're going to shut down stakeholders and the things that they're bringing as necessities to the application, or to the product, or to the experience, whatever it is that we're looking to focus around the user. And finally, it means that we're also assuming that from our position, even as conciliator, we are the ones to make the right choices. From this, as we go into the next module, we're going to look at how we can extract hypotheses from these stakeholder objectives. And from that, we are going to be able to test to see which ones actually resonate with users. We're going to do user study. So we're going to find out whether or not our stakeholders' assumptions are correct. But more importantly, and I think requiring a great degree of maturity in ourselves, we're going to discover whether or not our assumptions are in fact correct, whether or not our assumptions are something that we should be holding to. Just as a way of wrapping up my video feedback for this week, I'd just like to say thank you to absolutely all of you for the level of participation in the forums. It's been really, really fantastic. You know, this is quite a large class that we have running in this run of the course, and that brings with it a couple of interesting challenges. The first is, obviously, there's a tremendous amount of conversation that, as much as I'd love to answer to all of it, I'd spend all my time on the forum and not get through my day-to-day work, and it would be the same for all of you. At the same time, we've also got tremendous amounts of marketing to do, and I'm going to be sharing next week just a little bit of an insight into the kind of feedback that I'd like to provide. And for those of you who are doing well, those of you who are getting solid, you know, marks over 85% week on week, you know, you'll get a well done and a thanks from me. And if you'd like some more full feedback, by all means, please just send me a message directly, and I'm happy to give as long a feedback as you require. For those who might be struggling with the course, I'd like to focus on providing a little bit more detailed feedback to you, giving you a little bit more guidance, and then also sharing some general notes with the class through the video forum, so that you guys can get a sense of how I think that you can all improve in the course. But coming back to my point of thanks, I really think it's fantastic the level of engagement that everyone is showing. I know it's tough working and then also having to type up a lot of feedback to your teammates in the small groups, but it's really, really been fantastic. Don't forget, what you want to do is you want to put forward that substantive matter. You want to put forward you know, your own analysis of the situation. You want to then respond to your classmates, and then ultimately, you know, you want to synthesize a holistic viewpoint and share that. Some of you in the first group modules gave fantastic feedback in the assignment, but didn't really participate in the small groups. I want to encourage you, you know, don't be a wallflower from one perspective, but also don't be afraid. It's tough, I know, to put yourself out there and kind of express things and express your opinion on a situation. And there are always going to be people, whether it's in the forums in this course, or whether it's in boardrooms or in project offices or around a table, they're going to be people who are going to possibly be more extroverted and so on and so forth. But, you know, it's something incredibly important that if you're the quieter voice around the table, you can provide sometimes the most powerful insight. So it's not about being the loudest, it's not about being the most bombastic. What it is about sharing your genuine insight into what is being discussed. And don't be afraid, and always, I would encourage you all to recognize the contributions of one another. I think the ethos amongst one another in this course has been fantastic, and I want to encourage you all to continue with that. It's the key not only to making this online learning experience a powerful one, but actually it's an incredibly important skill when it comes to practicing UX, or indeed any sort of digital or collaborative process. It's something where strong communication, not loud communication, is the key to building really, really great products. And I think learning from the video, the stakeholder videos, we can see that there are always going to be tremendous contradictions. However, we can always approach a team, and we can always approach a problem as one that we can resolve those contradictions, and our role as UX practitioners is that opportunity to reconcile the differing voices, the differing needs, and in the end, acting as the advocate for the user throughout the process, always thinking about how can we make this better for the user? How can we address the user's needs in the most broadest way? In the case of chainmail, looking at security, looking at simplicity of design, simplicity of use, ease of sign up, but high levels of security once I am inside the application, and then dealing with the various use cases that we might have identified in the product use context in the last module. So I just want to say thank you all very much. I think the course is going really, really well. If any of you have any feedback, please, by all means, drop a message to Kirsten or myself. I know we've had some challenges early on in the course. I've shared that as well, where it's been a little bit difficult to get onto the VLE, but I think things are looking fairly well sorted now, and I'm excited for the coming weeks with the course, and I'll be providing a video each week, probably on a Saturday or Sunday, maybe a little bit earlier, building up to a higher rate of videos which I can share with all of you. You can view it on my YouTube channel, and I'll also be including the links in the VLE forums. So good luck. I hope you're all enjoying the course, and I'll see you all soon. Thanks.